This is Merryn Jose, and you're listening to MerlianPodcast.com. Today we have with us Dr. William A. Tiller, who is a fellow of the American Academy for the Advancement of Science. Professor Emeritus William A. Tiller of Stanford University's Department of Materials Science and Engineering spent 34 years in academia after 9 years as an advisory physicist at the Westinghouse Research Laboratory. Dr. Tiller has been avocationally pursuing serious experimental and theoretical study in the field of psychoenergetics. Dr. Tiller also appeared in the movie What the Bleep Do We Know, which brought his expertise to a very receptive mainstream audience. So welcome to the show, Dr. Tiller.
Well, thank you, Merryn. It's a pleasure to be here.
My first question is, you were very familiar with the work of Edgar Cayce in the early 60s.
Yes, indeed.
Can you tell us a little bit about his work and how it affected your life personally?
Well, I never did meet Edgar personally, but I met his son and used to play bridge.
Was that Hugh Lynn Cayce?
That was Hugh Lynn, yes, right.
Right.
And basically, the way Jean, my wife, and I got involved in going within was as we looked around for some material, the only thing that was really available in the early 50s was something about Edgar Cayce, the miracle man of Virginia Beach.
Right.
And so we reached out to that, and he, of course, was a remarkable, truly remarkable individual, and a very spiritual man, and a man who was, I would say, a very reliable electrode in terms of yielding excellent information and reproducible information, because he wasn't involved with the glamour of this stuff. He was involved in doing work.
Yes.
And so when we decided we wanted to start to meditate, we basically reached out to the Edgar Cayce people and learned his simple technique for meditation. And so we have followed and expanded on that for the last 45 years, and it looks perhaps quite different now, but at a core level, it's pretty much the same. And we got involved in, first of all, we went to their summer program. They used to have a program at Asilomar in California for 2 weeks, and that's where we started to get involved with the various speakers they had and the various people involved from Virginia Beach. And we got involved in their discussion group activities. Edgar and his initial group of, I think it was, no, I don't remember how many people it was, but in the early 30s, they lived for 7 years the material that he talked about and that they discussed. And then he wrote two little books called Search for God, Book One, Search for God, Book Two. When I would travel for business or such, I would often take those books with me as companions, and along with them something like the Bhagavad Gita and the Letters of the Scattered Brotherhood. Basically, I would say we really enjoyed that discussion group experience. We had about 13 people in ours, and it first started in someone else's home and then ended up in our home in Menlo Park, California. At that time, I was department chairman at Stanford. I enjoyed the mix of various different people with their views on what Edgar had written. Some of them are still alive, and they're still friends today.
Oh, wonderful.
And so it was a very good experience.
And obviously, these daily meditations, how did they affect your work in science? They must have...
Oh, they were incredibly important to it. The meditational technique was a very simple one of sitting in a straight-back chair, and there were two 10-minute segments. Well, the first 10 minutes was to focus on something in particular, and not let your mind wander. And kept, but it did wander.
Is that like looking at a candle flame or something?
It's the analog of that, but
yes.
You're doing it with your eyes closed, you're doing it within, and you would bring your mind back always to the focal point. And then at the end of the 10 minutes, then just let it go and then open yourself to whatever would flow in. And in that 10 minutes, your mind would wander and you'd bring it back to center. And if it kept wandering down the same path, maybe there was something important for you to understand about that path.
I see.
Well, as I practice that on a daily basis, and believe me, I took to meditation like a duck to water. It was very, it was like coming home to me. I found that as I practiced more and more, I could get to the place, there appeared to be no intermediate state, that there was the sharp point of focus or the point of just totally letting go and being at one with everything that was around you.
Mm.
And so I learned to timeshare these, that is to flip back and forth fairly quickly between them until, in fact, I was in both states at once. It was a very interesting experience. And then as a department chairman, with people coming through my door with problems or what they thought were problems or saying things that were not the problems they wanted to talk about, I would sense that they were not saying what they wanted to and would lead them to where they really wanted to go. And so it was the aspect of being open to be very loving with these individuals.
Yes.
And guide them there. And then in my consulting practice, in that case, it was very interesting also. I was a consultant for the DuPont Company for about 25 years, and I would have different people coming through my door every half hour to an hour with their technical problems. Many of them in areas that I was not truly expert, but by this aspect of loving care and nourishment of these individuals just through my biofield, plus being sharply focused on what they were telling me, I got to the place often where I could, in fact, almost sample their basic knowledge. And I could almost really couple to that and attune to that.
Mm-hmm.
And there were occasions where we did this so well, we became one. And when we reached that stage, our channel capacity for thinking broadened. It became the sum of the two. And then just huge ideas poured in that couldn't have come alone.
No.
It was quite a remarkable experience. So we did a lot of very good things, and in essence, I was serving them, what their needs were. You know, women do that in life all the time.
Yes.
With respect to husbands and children. Men don't do it so much.
No.
But I really appreciated that, and it really did come from getting involved with this particular kind of meditation.
It's rather like hemi-sync, isn't it, that you resonated left and right hemispheres of the brain and you had...
Yes, that would be a good way of putting it. It was a total integration from left and right hemispheres. I mean, as a young man, I started out as a poet and attracted this lovely woman who became my wife, you know, and then I became a scientist, and I'm not sure she was terribly happy with that.
But you kept the poet.
Well, in a way. Mm. I mean, the words changed. They became more technical. But anyway, it's been an interesting path.
Very. And during the 60s, I believe you met a number of people in the psychic world and were exposed to some very interesting phenomena. Can you tell us a little about some of the people you came in contact with that impressed you with their gifts?
Well, of course, I came in touch with Ingo Swann. I came in touch with Harold Sherman.
Mm.
I came in touch with a whole variety of people whose names I cannot remember. And then in the 70s, I came in touch with Muktananda. This went on and on and on. Lots and lots and lots of people in the field. And the thing I learned from the 60s, because 60s was kind of a period of discrimination, for Gene and I. In this particular case, it was, you know, you often go in with the assumption, and that's what we had, that anyone who has these gifts, and we knew about Edgar Cayce, but anyone that has these gifts, is it in a high probability they're going to be spiritual people? Well, we found that wasn't the case at all.
No.
Somewhere, most of them were not.
Mm-hmm.
Most are caught up in the glamour of it and all that stuff. Only a small number were really had it at an organismic level where they really did good work or they were born with it and it just became a natural part of their life. It was no big deal for them.
Actually, Edgar Cayce made a point of that, didn't he?
Yes. And so the interesting thing about the Cayce meditation often, it evolved for us into basically using a prayer as the focal point of the meditation, but focusing on the seven chakras one at a time as you go through something like the Lord's Prayer. And so from our experience in the 60s of doing this and contacting these people and the crazy, weird stuff that would be happening,
mm-hmm.
you had to go back to your center, your core of balance. You couldn't afford to let yourself get unbalanced. And that was an important lesson for us as well, to always return to your center.
Yes.
And that was really a high mark of the Cayce work, that you really needed to keep that core sacred let it be. You can go out and explore from that core, but always come back to it.
I believe, too, Edgar Cayce actually is one of my very favorites. I believe that you met Jane Roberts, too.
Oh, yes.
Who channeled
the
Seth
material. That was in the 70s.
Ah, it was in the 70s, okay.
Yes, basically.
Didn't Seth say he was an energy personality essence no longer focused in physical form or something like that?
Something like that. What happened was that it was about 1970 that I first developed my theoretical model, and then I worked on it for the next 6 years or so, and then really did a retake on it to bring it up to snuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I was very pleased with it, but I had no one to talk to about it. That's why I went to see Muktananda. He was in Berkeley at the time. And it was a lovely experience chatting with him about this. And he kept giving me poetry, and I kept asking him for science.
Oh.
In a certain kind of symbolic form.
Uh-huh.
And he didn't do that. He just kept providing poetry. And I knew he understood what I was talking about, but he'd never used that set of symbols. So he could not put the information into a format that I was looking for.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
And then I went with one of my students at the time, and he had suggested, why don't we go to see Jane Roberts? And we went to Jane's place, met she and her husband, and she was a nice woman, short.
Mm-hmm.
My mother was very short, so there was no problem with that. And she fed us well, we talked, chatted, and then after dinner she said, Seth's here, would you like to talk to him? And so I said, oh, sure. And so I sat on the edge of the couch to listen to her, because she had a fairly soft voice.
Yes.
And then this booming power voice came out of her, and it just pushed me right back on the couch.
How amazing.
It was physiologically quite amazing.
My.
And I related my theory, and Seth seemed to be delighted, and he was very gracious and in terms of his comments, and I just kept getting more and more puffed up by all this praise. And then he said, of course, all models of the universe are wonderful.
Oh.
It was like a pinprick.
Yes.
Yeah. Back to center.
But did you really feel that you were talking to a truly intelligent being?
Yes, I definitely did. I mean, the biofield went up orders of magnitude.
Mm.
And it was very powerful.
Mm.
And I've had Other experiences, I visited in England with Bertha Harris, who was a...
I don't know her.
Bertha Harris was a spiritualist medium.
Oh, yes.
Who used to do work with Charles de Gaulle and your English Prime Minister, I'm just... Churchill.
Oh, I was going to say Churchill?
It was Churchill, yeah.
Oh, he was interested in this.
I think he took information wherever he could get it. And she lived in London, and she was a nice lady.
Yes.
And everything she had to say to Jean and I was right on.
Really?
She didn't say one thing that was not correct. So we've had a number of experiences over the years in which we have worked with mediums and channels and sensitives, and some have been truly remarkable, truly, truly remarkable and correct, and some have not.
Yes. Do you think there's anyone today of the caliber of Cayce or Roberts or this other lady that you were talking about? I know Ingo Swann is
I don't know of them, actually. There, I suspect there are. I mean, Carolyn Meese is one of the best-known ones around these days.
Like a medical intuitive, right?
Yes, and I understand she's quite good, and I've met her, and I like her. But I've never really worked with her, so I can't give you first-hand experience. And first-hand experience is really what's crucial, as far as I'm concerned.
Of course. You're a scientist.
I have to feel people.
Yes.
I mean, it's one thing to talk the talk. It's another to walk the walk.
Yes.
So, you know, when you find someone who does both, I mean, that's a treasure.
Oh, yes, absolutely. In the early 70s, you read a book?
It was actually the late 60s. I read this little book. I had a Guggenheim Fellowship to go to Oxford for sabbatical. I was going to write a textbook in my field, the science of crystallization. And on the way to the airport, I picked up the Schroeder and Ostrander book, Some Psychic Discoveries Behind the Iron Curtain.
Yes, it was a big thing in England, too.
Yes.
Yes.
And I read it on the plane, and of course I knew a great deal about the materials they were talking about. I had corresponded with George Delawar on radionics for years in the late 60s, before I even went to England, but he was dead by the time I got there, but I spent time with Marjorie when I was there. But basically, it was the scope of the Russian work that impressed me. And I had this nagging thought, and I just couldn't release it. It was, how might the universe be constructed to allow this crazy-seeming kind of stuff to just naturally, seamlessly coexist with the conventional science I was doing at Stanford every day with my graduate student, and so on.
Yes.
When I got to Oxford and started to write the book I intended to write, I got the first two chapters done, but this thought just kept coming up again and again and again. And I decided I would try to use my inner techniques for answering this question. So by then, Jean and I were meditating an hour a day, and we went into meditation in the morning, and first we would go in when I started.
And you did it together, your meditation?
We always did it together.
Okay. Yeah.
And Jean is not scientific, but she's got a really good intuition.
Yes.
So, and that's very useful for me, you know, because as a scientist, you can charge down a particular channel, and sometimes it's hard to get out of that groove. And so if someone you think well of says, I don't see it that way. I see it this way, and have you ever thought about it that way?
Right.
And suddenly you change course, and that leads to the treasure. Anyway, it was a valuable thing for us to do, and we would go into meditation. I would hold the brick of this question.
Yes.
How might the universe be constructed to allow this crazy-seeming kind of stuff to seamlessly join with conventional science?
Right.
That is, what concepts must be invented? What things or assumptions that really aren't true? What experimental data, if any, gets violated by the model, etc., etc.? And I would come out of meditation after an hour, and I would talk with Jean about it, and then I would go and I'd work all day on the gleanings of of that period of time. And at the end of the day, I would have a bunch of other questions, sub-questions within the same framework. And then I would go in the next day with holding the main brick, but holding all these little sub-bricks of questions. And then an hour later, I'd come out and we'd talk about it, and then I'd work all day on these things. And I did that for 6 months.
Oh, my.
And at the end of 6 months, I had a model which would allow these to be seamlessly joined, or so it seemed at the time. And it didn't violate any experimental physics. It certainly violated some concepts that people were espousing.
Yes, of course.
But there was nothing to say that has to be false. Now the model is even richer, and... It